Yes, recording also started.
Let's imagine somebody throwing a stone into a pond. You know, the pond, when the stone gets thrown, there are lots of ripples which are created, and ripples travel outwards. And these ripples affect everybody in the pond. So, similarly, today, when globalization has caught up and connectivity is at an all-time high, and social media is giving us live updates what is happening all around the world, we are all connected with each other. And if you actually see, it's just like the movie Avatar, which was an all-time hit. And in that Avatar movie, they show an imaginary planet called Pandora, where the entire ecosystem is like one huge nervous system connected with everybody. All the inhabitants of the planet Pandora are actually connected with each other. And today the world is more or less like that. And the harmony, the word harmony, if you look it up in the dictionary, it's a pleasant musical sound created by sounding of different musical notes together. So, when we are talking about harmony in the world, it's about so many individuals all making sounds with their lives, with their lifestyles, and all of it together making a harmony out of it. So, and another word that comes to my mind is orchestra, right? So, Philharmonic Orchestra, when Zubin Mehta conducts, I had the occasion to hear him in Mumbai once, in the Brabourne Stadium. It was a huge musical ensemble, and he was conducting it brilliantly. It made such a beautiful harmony. And what struck me is that the musical players of different instruments, they can't play their own instrument out of sync with the rest of the orchestra. They need to subordinate their own individual personality. They need to, you know, see the musical notes and play the music. Then only the whole symphony comes together. The orchestra comes together. The harmony comes together. So, this answers one question which we had raised. That is, can we neglect the outer world and play your own instrument or lead your own life? Clearly, that is not possible if we have to create harmony. We need to see what everybody else is playing and play by the ear, as the Americans would say. So, that's first point. Secondly, another point I thought is extremely relevant is that all of us are playing different roles as if in a play in this world, right? So, in any different company or any different any organization, we all have a designation, we all have a specified role, function to carry out. And as long as we are doing that, we understand our role, we understand our function and carry it out, the whole machinery, organizational machinery works brilliantly. So, we need to subordinate our own individual desires or greed, may I say, and play the music while fully understanding our role. I think that is what leads to harmony. Now, so once we understand that internal harmony is extremely important to contribute towards the global harmony or the external harmony, let us see what are the various views. I would like to quote Dr. Yoichi Kawada, who is a director in the Institute of Oriental Philosophy, about the Buddhist worldview. He clearly brings out that there are three poisons: greed, hatred and ignorance, as per the Buddhist worldview, which actually spoils the social harmony and creates a vicious atmosphere. So at the individual level, we have to overcome greed, hatred and ignorance. And these three actually lead to rampant materialism, exploitation of nature and religious extremism. So you see how the internal or lack of internal harmony, how it leads to symptoms outside. In the Hindu worldview, I would like to quote the immortal Gita. In chapter 2, verse 71 says, Vihaya kaman yaha sarvan puman charati nisprahaha nirmamo nirahankaraha saha shanti madigachati. It says, any person who sacrifices his own desires or who overcomes his own desires, he roams free in this world, free from all his inner conflicts and full of peace. So I think it is an internal harmony which is extremely relevant. Finally, I would like to end with J. Krishnamurti, who said, society is nothing but product of relationships between people. It's a summation of relationships between two individuals summed up all over the world. Now, since individuals and their responses have got conditioned by religion, caste, creed, then maybe his education, so many factors, our responses have become extremely rigid. And this is what is leading to the conflict in the external world, spoiling the harmony. So, finally, my point is that we should live in the moment, be here and now, be spontaneous and react as human beings, hearing the symphony, musical notes created by others, and we will create external harmony as well. Thank you.
Yes, Kushalji.
Yes.
Kushalji, you will
try? Yes, yes, yes. First of all, I would like to wish a very, very good evening to my friends in India and a very good morning to my friends in the West. So, and I also thank the first speaker for starting on a very nice note. So, what I would like to point out is that what we call as the external world and what we call as the internal world are perhaps not as separated as what appears. Because what we call as the external world is accessible to us mainly through our senses. You know, that whether there is a table in front of me or whether there is a person in front of me or whether there is a car in front of me, I know that only through my senses. I do not have any direct way of, knowing about that object or that person in front of me. So what we actually call external world is a representation of certain things that seem to be outside us in our own mind. And what we call internal world is in some sense a set of impressions and samskaras which we have gathered already over the course of this lifetime or perhaps even previous lifetimes. So what we are talking about, harmony between the external world and the internal world, is perhaps in some sense a harmony between our samskaras which we have gathered in the past and the sensory inputs which we are receiving in the present. Now obviously if these two things are not in harmony, that our samskaras which we have built over the past have some kind of lack of resonance or lack of similarity with the sensory inputs which we are receiving in the present, there is bound to be some amount of disturbance or lack of peace in our minds. So in this sense, we cannot really neglect either of them, you know, that we must be sensitive towards, you know, our past, you know, samskaras, and we must understand what is it that we carry, which makes our internal world, and we accordingly then have to, you know, ensure that the sensory inputs which we are taking from the outside is in resonance with that pre-existing samskaras. Because if they are not in harmony, then, you know, our, you know, what we call as peace or, you know, sense of well-being is going to be disturbed. So again, to kind of repeat what I just said, is that what we think as external is not really external. It is, you know, again, just, you know, what our senses are telling us about the world. Because what I think the person is in front of me may actually be very different from what the person actually is. You know, what I know about that person is only my own internal representation of that person. So thinking of things as external is perhaps not a very correct way of thinking about them. It's perhaps better to think of them more as, you know, perceptions or our own interpretations, and then work to, you know, create harmony between what kind of inputs we take, because that's also a choice that I have. You know, that when a person is, say, you know, standing in front of me, that person may have 1,000 qualities and maybe saying 1,000 things and, you know, maybe giving, you know, 1,000 different signals towards me. But what I take in some sense, can be decided by me to some extent. So if we can harmonize that what kind of sensory input we take from what appears to be outside, and if we can make that in harmony with our internal samskaras, then, you know, there is a much higher chance of us being in a state of peace. So with this, I would like to end my first round, and I would like to request Sanjeev ji to kindly share his views.
So I want to show my screen. Can I be made the organizer? Hello.
Yes, I've made you the presenter.
So is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay, so namaste, good morning, and good evening. So I want to start this talk now. The title is Harmony. And the way I understand harmony is, it is coexistence. Coexistence between the various entities in this universe. And the views which I'm going to present here are my personal views. And these views have been gathered over years from many sources, and it is difficult for me to list down all the sources, but these are all my personal views, and they do not represent the places with which I work. So first thing which I want to highlight is the various levels of harmony. So we operate at different levels. One is at the level of human being, which I am calling as self, so which consists of a conscious being. We call it by different names, and a body, and there is some kind of harmony which is required between the two. Then we also operate at the level of family, and this family could mean different things to different people, but whatever it is, we always operate in a smaller group where we live, and it is more than one human being, so I'm calling it as family. Then we also operate at the level of community, where there are more than one families living together. So these communities could be at a local level. When we keep increasing the size of the community, we go to the level of nation, and finally global. On this planet Earth, we can call this as a global community. The next level is when we start thinking of beings other than the human beings, or we start thinking of other orders, starting from the material order, the plant order, or the animal kingdom. So we have all these things which are also there in nature, and we have to appreciate those also when we are talking of harmony. And finally, other than our planet, there are whole lot of other planets, solar systems, galaxies, which also need to be kept in mind. So when we are talking of harmony, I think we need to talk of all these levels. So which one is internal and which one is external depends on the level at which we are discussing. So if I am talking of myself as internal, then everything else becomes external. And similarly, if I take my family as internal to me, then anything outside is external. And similarly with communities, nation, and planets. So the question which comes is harmonious living possible? So that is a fundamental question which one has to address within oneself. If the answer is no, one can look into it. Why is it not possible? What is stopping us from living harmoniously? What is wrong? And if it is possible, then we have to figure out what we are missing, why we are not able to live harmoniously. Similarly, the next question is the whole existence as it exists today, is it coexistence? Or what we sometimes say that no, there is so much of competition, so there is some survival required and the survival can only be of the fittest, so we should become fit. So it all depends on the paradigm which we have in mind. And it also relates to what we want to achieve in life. Resources on this planet are definitely limited. So if everyone wants to own a planet, then obviously all of us cannot live on this planet. And if we look at the nature very closely, we find that nature has a lot of cyclic orders which tend to create a balance in the nature. And that needs to be understood. So in these cyclic orders, life and death kind of phenomena look more like events. So it is important to understand that in one life, how much we can achieve is also something going to be limited. So what is the expectation from one life? And if we believe in life after life, then what is the continuity there? That needs to be looked into and to be understood well. So in this part of the presentation, I think I would just like to conclude again. So what is internal and what is external? When we talk of internal and external harmony, depends on at which level we are talking. So I think the previous two speakers mainly focused on the aspect of human being as internal and anything outside is external. But it is possible that we say of internal harmony within a country and anything external can also be called as external. And then we talk of external harmony, our relations with other countries and so on and so forth. So at this stage, I think this is all I would like to share and then I can continue later. Thank you.
Please can you continue with your comments on what the other two speakers have said? So we can have the round two now. So Sanjeevji, you can give your views on what me and Guru Prasad ji have said.
Okay, so I think in some sense I have already mentioned. So the other two people have focused more on human being as a, when you talk of human being at the level of human being as internal harmony, and when you talk of other things, then you talk of external harmony. So that is the level one, which is the level of a human being, which is self. But harmony has many more levels, and each of these needs to be looked at very carefully. Otherwise, sometimes we don't see the relation between our own evolution, our own realization, and what is happening to the society around us. I would also like to talk a little bit about some more questions which come to mind. One is, of course, all of us know and all of us say that we are all human beings, we are all social beings, But sometimes we also think that we can live alone and we can maybe become better in isolation. So that question needs to be looked at very carefully. One can be very good in isolation as an individual, but can he live in harmony with all other things? That needs to be looked at very carefully. Especially because a lot of things happen at a collective level. For example, the pollution is the effect of all of us doing something. So even if one person decides not to touch upon other things, but pollution will still be there because all of us, it is the effect of collective, everyone put together. And there is the second aspect that we cannot bypass any level. So we will be living in this planet. So if we are living on this planet, we will be in some country. And if we are in some country, then we will be in some location. Our food will come from somewhere. There will be some animals, some material order. So all those things are going to be there. And if you don't know how to deal with them, then we may not be able to live harmoniously with them. Just like we try to understand the physical laws, I think probably we need to look at mechanisms also in existence, which are there, which are inbuilt mechanisms, so that we understand what is the harmony in nature. So probably it is due to our limited understanding of reality that we are not able to live harmoniously with other human beings and with the animals also. So I think these are the other comments I have. So from my side, I think thank you for joining.
Yes, please. Now it's your turn, so give your comments.
Yeah, thank you. I think both the other speakers, Kushalji and Sanjeevji, spoke brilliantly. I must compliment them on bringing out very unique perspectives. I think Kushal spoke about the two simultaneous perceptions or two simultaneous views which are combining. One is the external world as perceived through senses, and which is a real-time feed, so to say. And another is the past, samskaras, which are, you know, recorded on the hard disk of the brain. And so that is also being superimposed on the external, stimuli which are pouring in, and the response from the individual gushes forth. That's a brilliant way to, actually understand how the human being perceives the reality at any time, and I fully go with that. But only one doubt I had, probably Kushal during his turn could elaborate. He somewhere mentioned that the external world, what we perceive through our senses, if that is in alignment with what our samskaras are. So my question to him would be, the external world is not in your circle of control, right? So that is there, that nothing you can do about it. So are you talking about calibrating your own sense perception to suit your own samskaras? Because something is out there, nothing I can do about it. So I cannot alter that reality or alter that, situation outside. And your point is brilliant. I cannot really alter my samskaras, what has been recorded earlier. And as I think Sanjeevji brought in, it's not only over one life, it is over many lives. And there may be a conflict. So, but I take your point that I think our values, as long as our values are in alignment with the eternal laws of this world, eternal laws of the nature, the right kind of samskaras will be recorded, and that I think is key. If the right kind of samskaras are there, then automatically they are not in conflict with what is being seen outside, because the recording on the hard disk are being done correctly in alignment with the values. So that is one point which I thought I could highlight. And Sanjeev also spoke brilliantly. He spoke about various levels, and I think he clearly brought out that the harmony is depends on the framework. What is the framework on which you are operating? And one thing that struck me when he was speaking was that if an individual's sense of identity, if it expands, so to say, like in case of many saints, they would say that their consciousness embraces this whole world. That means nothing is external to them. Their entire consciousness actually encompasses all the beings. And why only beings? This whole world. Anything, any happens anywhere, probably it happens in their consciousness. So if one can reach that level, then everything will be internal. And as I think this tallies with what J. Krishnamurti also said. He said your mind is the result of millions of years of human evolution. That means somewhere whatever is happening in this world gets recorded, and that is part of your past samskaras, and that again resonates with what Kushal spoke about, your past samskaras. So I think it is essential that all of us need to cultivate our perception, senses of perception, to record this external reality accurately. I think I am sitting among two, you know, eminent technocrats. So accuracy of recording is very important. So I think as long as the reality is recorded accurately, then I think when they are playing back, it is in perfect harmony with the world that is being observed, and I think there will not be any conflict then, and then internal and external harmony will be achieved. I think, thank you. I would like to hand over to Kushal ji now.
Thanks a lot, Guru Prasad ji. I personally think that this has been a, you know, great panel discussion, because I think what all three of us have spoken is in some sense, you know, fits very well into a, you know, and makes kind of a, you know, nice theme. Because the first point which was pointed out was that, you know, this scene from the fantastic movie, that, you know, the whole nature is connected. You know, it's really a beautiful movie, which I would recommend all to watch. So, you know, everything is connected, you know, that what we call as individual, what we call as, you know, what is outside us, everything is connected by a network, you know, kind of a thing. But yet we see individuals, you know, as it was pointed out by the other speaker, that, you know, that it is not just, you know, individual human beings, but even, you know, a state, a district, a family or a country can also act as individual, and one can see internal, external with respect to that. So this is one of the, you know, deepest questions in Indian philosophy, and, you know, so far, you know, it has not really been settled that what is an individual, because, you know, Dvaita on one hand says that, you know, that man is, you know, one individual, you know, which is separate from another human being, whereas the other extreme of Advaita says that, you know, there are no such things as individuals, you know, everything is just, you know, one Atman or one Brahman. So where the reality is really, perhaps, you know, we have to experience to know, but it is, what I would like to point out is that it is still a, you know, open question and worthy of another panel discussion perhaps. And to kind of answer the question which was posed just now, that you know, that the what perceptions are pouring in my mind, that is not really under my control, you know, that I have the external world, and so many perceptions are pouring in my mind. How do I go about it and, you know, create harmony? Because samskaras are not under my control, they are already there from the past. Perceptions are not under my control, so what do I do? So this again, you know, requires a lot more discussion and debate before we can come to any conclusion. But what I would like to point out in brief is that there are certain aspects of our interaction with the world which are not under our control, and certain aspects which are under our control. For example, I'm living in Delhi right now. The air I breathe in is not under my control. You know, how much of, you know, oxygen is going in, how much of, you know, fresh air is going in, how much of pollutant is going in, that I really have no control about. But for example, you know, do I choose to be in a place which is more near the trees or, you know, more near the, you know, cars and the roads? That is something that is perhaps within my control. Or say when I meet a human being, you know, in my workplace or in my family, what kind of impressions do I carry with me about that person or about that conversation that I had? That is in some sense under my control, you know. Do I focus more on only the negative qualities of that person, or do I see that person only in positive light, or do I see that person in totality? You know, that I know the, you know, good things, bad things about that person, and I have a balanced perspective, you know, that okay, that, you know, everybody has some plus minus, and you know, one could think of it that way. So yeah, so in brief, what I would say is that, you know, that we have some control over certain kind of perceptions, and we do not have control over certain other kind of perceptions. And then, you know, one has to, you know, then work accordingly depending on, you know, each of these categories to, you know, maximize the harmony between what exists within us and what fresh inputs we are taking from outside. So that's all I have to say, and I thank the panelists very much for sharing their views. It was really a wonderful discussion that I had. I really learned a lot from this, and I hope to see them again here in the future. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yes. Swamiji would like to say something.
Namaste everybody. This is Swami Chidananda. Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. All I want to say is this has been a new experience for us. I think it's a great beginning. And it's a different challenge to listeners to put together the views of three panelists and reflect on it. By and large, this is a good learning experience. So I compliment you for this initiative, and we look forward to seeing the three of you or any other combination in future. It's really a good, like a breeze of fresh air. Thank you.
We have one question from the audience. The question says, I think the purpose of our existence is not only to enjoy the process of living, but also to expand our consciousness to the level of universe. Is it correct? So I would request one of the panelists to please take it up.
I have a difficulty in appreciating the understanding of word consciousness. But what I can say from my own understanding is, yes, we have to understand the reality in totality, which means we have to understand material order, we have to understand the plant order, we have to understand the animal order, the human beings, the interrelationships between all these, and the existence in general. So in that sense, we have to understand everything, and if that means expanding the consciousness, yes, it is. Thanks.
Would you like to?
Well, I was when I was hearing, you know, I think Kushalji. One more example came to my mind. I think I live in the city of Bengaluru, where the traffic can be extremely chaotic at times. And I often find, you know, the two-wheeler riders, they go on the footpath and, you know, suddenly crash, land back into the road right at the signal. So You see, when you are talking about harmony, I think it is extremely essential for every person to be sensitive to the, you know, the laws of traffic, in case of traffic, but also at the same time understand how these laws are made, what are the purpose, what is the overall scheme of things. And you see, if you go to the RTO for issue of a driving license, I think he shows you a lot of symbols, whole lot of things which many of us see only at the time of getting the license. After that we don't bother seeing, but the point is that consciousness has to be there about the overall scheme of things. And this particular question, basically it talks about that purpose of human life. Purpose of human life is to evolve. Purpose of human life is to develop during one's own lifetime to embrace a higher level of consciousness. I think it's a very nice way of putting the goal of life, where you need to focus on your own evolution, and whether it leads to embracing the universal consciousness or not, I think it's difficult to say, but it definitely seems like a worthy goal. Thank you.
Sarji, we cannot hear you.
Sorry. I was mute. So I've just unmuted myself. Yeah. So I would just like to add, you know, one point to this, and say that, you know, what we call enjoying the process of living is actually not very different from the process of expanding our consciousness. You know, because the moments in life where we have felt joy, you know, are the moments where our consciousness has expanded. You know, although for a very short time. So what would be called a spiritual process is to keep this process of expansion going on and not make it, you know, limited to 1 second or 1 minute or 2 minutes of a day. But, you know, for the whole day, for the whole month, you know, our consciousness should keep expanding. So that is perhaps, you know, what is the spiritual process as compared to normal living, where, you know, our consciousness, you know, keeps expanding, contracting, you know, complicated process. Okay, so the next question is regarding a very interesting point. So it says that hello.
Yeah, it's from Rita Singh. Which you are?
So I'm reading the question from Mr. Sriram.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So the question says that. In his book Kindle Life, talks about the alignment at four different levels: physical, emotional, intellectual, and spiritual, in order to achieve perfect harmony. Could you comment on that? I've unmuted the speakers. So,
Guru Prasad ji.
You want me to? Okay, Sriram speaker, we can, yeah. NL Shrita, mic is on. Can you please hear me? Yes, Kushal. Can you please answer the question, panel Sriram? Any of you?
Okay, I think as I understand, hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, as I understand the question, basically he says is that at the physical, emotional, intellectual levels, the perception takes place. So is the harmony to be achieved at all these levels? I think this is what I understood from the question. Now, my My take on this is that while these are different levels, I would say they are at there is a certain order. That means at the deepest level, at the highest level, if you perceive things correctly, then all the other grosser levels will fall in alignment. So if your deepest beliefs, your deepest faith, if that is in correct alignment and that is in synchronization with the universal laws of this world, then at physical level you cannot do any wrong, right? It is like walking the talk or walking the thought, so to say. So I think you need not achieve harmony level by level. It is driven by the deepest faith, deepest your perception, and as long as that perception you have achieved internal harmony, the rest of it takes care of itself, and you need not bother about it separately. I don't know if I've answered the right question, answered correctly, because I'm not very sure what the questioner meant. Yeah, thank you.
There's a question from Rita.
I can just add that, of course, we need to understand the various aspects of a being, which include the physical being, the emotional part, the intellectual part, and the spiritual part. So there has to be a proper understanding, and with the understanding, you have to live harmoniously. So I would just say, yes, it is important to focus, but a being is a continuous being, so this demarcation and the words which we are using are only words to understand a certain aspect of the being. So the being has to be in harmony. Whether you classify into 3 or 4 parts or 10 parts, it is up to you. Thank you.
So we can now go to the next question, which says, but you cannot force people to be conscious. So it is not a question but a comment. So would any one of you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I would say, so you decide for yourself whether you want to be conscious or not, and leave others to decide for themselves. Because if you take charge for others, then you cannot do everything. So if you take charge of yourself, you decide what is good for you, and the things will fall in place.
Yeah, I think I would like to go back to my example of traffic, right? If you don't follow the laws, then you are at great risk. A truck may just, run over you, and which is what happens when you are not driving, following all the rules. Sooner or later, somebody who's following the rule correctly will knock you off. So I think it's at great risk. And today, many of the accidents in the world are happening because people are not leading their lives in alignment with the laws of this world, with the laws of universal tolerance. And that is the reason why many of the things that are taking place in this world are indeed taking place. So I think there is no choice, really. So whether while people cannot force you to be conscious, the overall scheme of things will force you in a way, by knocking you off, right? By dealing you such a blow that you have no other choice but to fall in line. Thank you.
So we have one more question, which says, what are the different ways of evolving ourselves to a higher level? So what are the different ways of evolving ourselves to a higher level? So any one of you would like to take that?
Well, I think Kushalji, you should take it.
Okay. So as per our Indian way of thinking about it, there are 4 aspects that make a human or any being, which is one is action, which we do our interaction with the external world. One is our thoughts in some sense, which can be categorized as knowledge. One is our emotions, and one is our energy. There are four, again, different systems of yoga which have been built based on these four things. What works through action is known as karma yoga. What works through emotions is known as bhakti yoga. What works through thoughts or knowledge is known as jnana yoga. And what works through energy is known as kriya yoga. So sometimes, people say that, okay, you can pick up any one of them and, work with that and, go to a higher level, but that works at a very rudimentary, kind of a level, because after you have, made some progress, you have to make use of all four of them. It is not possible to, focus only on karma and, neglect bhakti and neglect jnana, because after a point you cannot do karma with the right spirit if your, emotions and thoughts are not, and your energies are not, developed, enough. So when we talk of different ways, the difference comes only in the, the personal, the kind of personal idiosyncrasies or the personal choices that we make regarding, say, which God do I worship or, what karma do I do. But if we see the essence, of any, spiritual path, at the core, there is not much difference actually, because you have to, at the essence, work with your karma, work with your emotions, work with your thoughts, and work with your energies. So only a very refined and very, well, done combination of these four, systems which make a being can actually, lead to long-term growth, which is sustainable in a very, very solid way, and which does not get disturbed by, what we call external sensory inputs. So I would like to just to put emphasis that there are not different ways, but that personal emphasis may be slightly different, but at the essence there is only one way, that we have to combine all these four aspects of our life and use all of them to grow in a very coherent and harmonious way. So would any of you like to add to that?
I would just like to add, maybe if we are sincere about what we want and we keep looking for people who are also sincere and who are looking forward to interaction with similar interest, probably that will help us to move forward and understand things better.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, Sanjeev, there, because I think somewhere I heard that the universe conspires to put you in the place which is most conducive for your growth, right? And I think so the world takes care of that too. Only thing is, we need to understand that and we need to accept. Many times we are fighting with our own situation and thinking that, yes, I should have been born in US and I should have been doing this and that and things like that. We don't accept as the things as they come to us on a plate, so to say. So we must accept whatever comes to our own lot in life and try to make the best of it. And with that spirit, if we go on, I think it will lead to the evolution for sure. Thank you.
There is one Rahul Bose who has raised the hand. Vishalji.
Yeah, so he has written his question in the box. So he kind of refers to a point which I made earlier. So he kind of says that he made a point about how it is up to us as to what perception we pick up about another individual. I believe that we should try to focus on the good aspects of every individual we meet. I am reminded about the Freudian concept of stroking. By focusing on the positive aspect of every other person we meet, we give a positive stroke and in return get a positive stroke from that individual. In this way, perhaps, we are looking at better harmony. So what he's suggesting is that perhaps, we should focus on the positive aspects of every individual and that will perhaps, lead to better harmony. So I kind of you know disagree with that, you know, which is okay in a panel discussion, I think. what I believe is that what we call positive and what we call negative are again our own mental constructs. You know that something which might appear positive to me might appear very negative to you, and something that appears negative to me might appear positive to you. So what we call positive and negative are, you know, notions that we have made in our own minds for our survival, you know, which is also important. You know, I'm not saying there is anything wrong with that, but that is something that, you know, one thing that you know, I think we need to understand that that what exists in the world is not necessarily positive or negative, but, you know, the way we think about it. So it is possible that, you know, something that appears negative, you know, on the outside might actually be positive if we start thinking about it, you know, from a deeper perspective. And the second point is that when we are, you know, talking of harmony, it is in some sense related to the idea of totality. That, you know, if you are saying that I am in harmony with that person, I cannot be in harmony with only, you know, one aspect of that person or only one half of that person. I have to be in harmony with that person as a whole. So if I have some, you know, qualities which appear negative to somebody, you know, that will definitely, you know, lead to disharmony, you know, at some point of time. So I feel that, you know, instead of, you know, limiting our perception or, you know, our focus only to the positive parts, we perhaps need to, you know, see every situation and every person in totality, to whatever extent possible, to whatever extent, you know, we have, you know, grown ourselves to see the things in totality, and not be perturbed by things which might appear negative. I think that's perhaps a better state to be in, rather than, you know, neglecting or trying not to see what, you know, might appear as negative qualities.
Rahulji, you want to say anything? I have unmuted you. Rahul Bose.
Rahul?
Okay. I think the number of questions indicates that I think we have had a good discussion, and it has provoked a lot of thinking amongst our audience. I think to that extent, I think we should consider this panel discussion fairly successful.
He has given his response. He says that I disagree. Positive and negative are to some extent absolute concepts. Like Mr. Guru Prasad mentioned, there are rules we have to follow. So it's okay. As in, we can perhaps take the discussion offline, I think, because
can I make one comment on this?
Please.
I just want to add that in a day we have day and then night. So there is sunlight and part of the day when there is no sunlight. So one can say one is positive, another one is negative. But both are important for life, and one should know what to do when. That is the only thing. So what we consider as positive and what we consider as negative, of course, may look relative, but one should sort of evolve to understand what is to be done when in one's own life. So there is no hard and fast rule of saying that we should sleep as soon as the sunlight goes off and get up as soon as the sunlight comes on, but one should know what is what meant for. Both are important.
Can I add, I think when you spoke about day and night, I thought you were going to come to dawn and dusk, right? So between black and white, there is gray. So what do we do in when it comes to gray? So there are gray areas for sure, and all of us are aware, and especially when it comes to emotions, when it comes to the subjective part of things, it is very difficult. It often becomes very difficult to see what is right and what is wrong. And while I agree with Rahul that we should respond with positive to the positive and try to see positive, and that is what the whole question is, what do you see as negative? So I think in the complex world of human interaction, as I think all it has come out very clearly, we must treasure our positive aspects and go out into the world with the best of intentions, right? And then, as Sanjeev ji has brought out, we should, at the spur of the moment, we should react. And if the intentions are right, the right actions will spring forth. Yeah, thank you.
So we have one final comment which says that some have achieved solace simply through bhakti, like Tukaram and Mirabai. So maybe this is one way of achieving Nirvana. Yeah, this is definitely, you know, again, true in some aspect, but what I would like to add here is that, you know, when we, you know, think of people like Tukaram and Mirabai, what we see from the outside is their bhakti, you know, because we have seen their songs and because we have seen their, you know, emotional upsurges. But, you know, we cannot really say that, you know, their, you know, jnana coefficient or their karma coefficient or energy coefficient was low. Just that they chose to express the bhakti coefficient more strongly to the external world, you know. But unless we know a person, you know, properly, you know, by actually having interactions with that person, you know, it is very difficult to know, you know, what other qualities that person may have. As in, one example that comes to my mind is the person who was a founder of Advaita in some sense, who was also known as Adi Shankaracharya. So when we talk to people, you know, it might appear that he was primarily an Advaitin or a Jnani. But actually, when you read about his life and what the kind of things you do, you know, the kind of things he did, the amount of karma that he was involved in, the amount of bhakti that he was in, he wrote Bhaja Govindam, you know, and the amount of kriya that he was involved in, you know, he had the power to leave his body, take up another body, you know, do certain things just to answer a question that was posed by, you know, one of the females he was debating with. So, you know, on the outside, it appears that Shankaracharya was outright a jnani, you know, full stop. But actually, if you, you know, go a little bit deeper, you will realize that his other qualities were, you know, as developed as his jnana. So, you know, so yeah, as in, so yes. Anybody would like to add to that?
I think you answered brilliantly. There is nothing much that can be added.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, there is one more comment. One more way to achieve it is through karma yoga, doing our duty. If we all do our duty consensuously, perhaps we can achieve harmony. I think this can be a very interesting topic for a future panel discussion, perhaps.
Yes.
Karma yoga. Any panelists would like to add to say something about this point?
What is duty needs to be understood. What comes as a force from someone is obviously not duty. So in the scheme of things, when we join a job and our boss tells us to do something, I don't know whether that we can call as duty within the framework of that company. So if you understand duty from the existential perspective, probably it should be okay.
Yeah, sure.
Very interesting. Aap kuch add karna chahenge? Would you?
Not really. I think karma yoga, I think you have also dwelt at length, and I think it is quite right what the question also that has come, but as you said, the deeper do you delve into it, it becomes a totally different discussion.
Okay, thank you. I think we are done with the questions. So Vibhaji.
Okay, thank you all. Very well done, and it was really interesting panel discussion. Definitely we can have one.
Okay, thank you. Good night. Thank you, Sanjeev. Vibhaji. Thank you, Kushal. It was nice.
Sabko namaste.
Thank you.